For 100 years, immigrants from around the world have been Alberta bound, and they brought their music with them. This summer, well, I return to the province that I grew up in to trace that music to its roots.
Whenever I get home and I get, you know, on the road and headed towards the farm where I grew up, I get very rural. I like the city, but I just like to go trudge through creeks, you know, and go see where they end up. And that's what Alberta offers. I come home, and I do, I change. My wife says that I talk different, and I do, I feel different. And I'm just much closer to the kid than I was, I think.
Sunset, 40 miles to Canada, my truck tore across Montana. Ian Tyson sang a lonesome lullaby. And so I cranked up the radio, 'cause there's just a little more to go before I cross the border at that sweet grass sign. I'm Alberta bound, this piece of heaven that I found. Rocky mountains and black fertile ground. Everything I need beneath that big blue sky. It doesn't matter where I go, this place will always be my home. I have been Alberta bound for all my life, and I'll be Alberta bound.
Terry Clark has taken the country music world by storm. She was born in Montreal, but she was raised in Medicine Hat. Behind me, of course, is Calgary. We've got the Calgary Tower right there, but more importantly, the Saddle Dome, where in February of 1998, Terry had her triumphant homecoming concert right there.
I played the Crescent Heights High School Spring Tea. That was my very first public appearance singing in Medicine Hat. From that point on, I entered some talent contests at the Westlander Inn, and Ray Fox, who was running this local talent show on local cable, put me on TV. Just snowballed from that point on. Whenever I think back to the beginnings and my roots in music and where it all started with a dream sitting on the edge of my bed with a guitar in the basement on 43 Hatcher Court, Medicine Hat, and that's exactly where all of that started, where it was all born, and none of this would be happening if it hadn't been born there, so there must be a lot of good energy floating around Alberta.
What my heart needs now is rest, so I'm packing up and I'm headed west. My mind's made.
The most recent video I shot in Alberta was A Little Gasoline, and I wanted to kind of honor my family and the Alberta tradition and have pump jacks going and have the mountains in the background and show the grain elevators and gasoline alley signs. People ask me why I wear the hat and where I got that idea from, and you're from Canada. I'm like, oh, you haven't been to Alberta. You know, if you've been to Alberta, you'd understand why I wear the hat. It fits very well. Thank you.
Pushing myself and this old machine, burning
. There are certain moments, I think, in my career where I've just felt, I just can't believe that this really happened. You know, I dreamed it and I wanted it really bad and went after it, and that this happened. And that was one of those moments when I did that show at the Saddle Dome and they filmed it for the special. I couldn't believe all these people were there to see me and all these cameras were there, and they built this big set, and I was just having this out-of-body experience. Like, somebody wake me up right now. And I flash back to sitting on my bed in Medicine Hat with my guitar and looking at all the pictures of Reba and the Judds and all these people on the wall just wanting to be like them. And there I was, touching it, you know.
I want a road stretching out before me. I want a radio in my ear. I want a full tank of absolution, no fear.
Having that song come out in Canada as a sort of theme song for the Special Olympics, I was so proud of her.
I want the world to just keep on turning. I want the dawn in my rearview mirror.
I'm honored to be Canadian, and I found out almost by accident that I became the first Canadian female Grand Ole Opry member, and I had no clue that no other woman was a member of the Opry, and I just feel so honored to be a part of that.
I want peace, love, and understanding, a stogie and an ice-cold beer. Don't want to live afraid of dying.
I don't think there was a dry eye in the house that night. That was, to this day, that is by far my favorite performance of hers. My favorite, and I think it always will be.
No fear. No fear.
I'm so proud to be from Canada that, you know, I wear my maple leaf tattoo very proudly wherever I go, and some people go, what kind of flower is that? So I start singing the national anthem.
Coming up next, Nickelback.
I feel tough when I listen to Nickelback. I knew I liked one song, so I bought the disc and then ended up listening to that disc all last summer. I think meeting them in hand is going to be the best part of this trip. We're in town. We're kind of cruising, Hannah. We're looking for Nickelback. Did you know them?
Oh yeah.
You did?
I went to school with them.
You did?
Mm-hmm.
All of them.
Yep.
Really?
When they were in school.
Why, Janie, I can't sleep. Oh, but thank you for coming.
They were cut from a different cloth than the farm boys, that's for sure.
I didn't want this. Somebody help me breathe.
I was one of the members in Village Idiot, the pre-Nickelback.
Village Idiot.
Village Idiot.
Oh, okay.
So, and anyone who's a Nickelback fan will be well aware.
Will know that.
The name of
So, and if they were really true Nickelback fans, then they'd be laying roses at this garage because this is where you used to practice, right?
Quite possibly. This is where it all began. When we were looking for a place to practice, there was a previous band that used to practice there. We approached them and they said, yeah, you can do it.
I can still hear them.
Astounding as to how many bands there were. There must have been six bands in a town of 3,000 people. Oh, I was probably 15. I thought I was a really good guitar player. I would wait for my chance to go into the garage and jam, because sometimes they just keep jamming, and if they knew that people were knocking at the door, they just wouldn't even let you in. And so there'd be like 10 kids just wanting to get in there to jam. And then if you were lucky enough to get in and sit down, you'd have to wait till everybody was done jamming and then see if somebody else felt like, you know, playing a couple of songs. Then you'd grab a guitar and you'd go up and try and play something. It was just like audition central. But when you got into the garage, it was cool. It was like so cool because it's where everybody wanted to be.
Skyreach Center for the first time. That was our biggest accomplishment to that point, playing live. It was pretty good kind of homecoming for us.
He left without saying goodbye.
Anytime we get back to Alberta and we play a show, there is this weird love in the room. I think that our fans from Alberta are really proud of us, and I think it shows. When we start playing, you can see it on our faces. We're just so happy to be there, and we're just trying to give back as much of that love as possible.
Well, that and your whole grad class in the mosh pit.
And my whole grad class in the mosh pit doesn't hurt either. My grandfather's house was right on the edge of town, and I would look over those hills and I would think to myself, there's got to be something out there waiting. There's got to be something bigger beyond this waiting for me. I'm surprised how many times I think of that little town, you know, all the time. Like, so much, so many good memories and so much nostalgia and so much, so many good times and good people.
Coming up on Alberta Bound, K.D. Lang. Sounds strange, but it feels like I'm back home. And I'm always in such a rush when I do come back to Alberta that it's nice to be able to just take a look. It's been a long time since I just had a good look. One of the surprises of the trip was Corb Lund, the alternative country singer some people say may be the next Ian Tyson. Corb cut his teeth playing small towns like Nanton along the foothills of the Rockies.
One year at the Raymond Stampede, they had six shoots with six broncs, and there's a Lund brother on every one of them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So there's rodeo in your background, too?
Yeah, I rodeo as a kid. Like, I rode steers and stuff until I was 15 or something. And I bulldogged a little bit in high school, but that's right when I got into music, so I kind of veered off from it. The high water mark of my rodeo career was 1981. I won second place day money in the steer riding at Calgary. That was a big deal.
That's not bad.
And Dad won the Bulldog. Dad was second overall in the Bulldog in that year, so that was kind of cool for us. The band's doing quite well, which is great, and the shows are getting bigger, which is also great for career reasons. But
sure,
the bigger the shows get, the less fun they are for me. Like, the Auditorium Hotel is great because it's just kind of real character little rooms, eh? They're very old, and they haven't been upgraded to match the modern decor of everything else, so they're really neat. And it's...
Does it just feel right to play in a place like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, and they've got the guns in the walls and the bad taxidermy. And I come here strictly for the taxidermy.
Chev got stuck in the Ford, got stuck, got the Chevron stuck when the Dodge showed up. The Dodge got stuck in the tractor rut, which eventually pulled out the Ford with some difficulty. Well, more rain than we'd seen for a thousand years caused financial joys and biblical fears. It caused some smiles, it caused some tears, but more to the point of our story. For the first time in the collective memory, that old brown prairie that had been so dry for so long was very muddy, boggy and sticky. We'd pull one truck out and get another stuck in, and motors would roar and tires would spin. We'd sink right down to the diff, and we'd all take turns, do it again till no one could move. We'd call one more friend, come on out here, Lance, we need you, bring your truck. Chev got stuck in the Ford, got stuck in the Chevron, stuck when the Dodge showed up. The Dodge got stuck in the tractor rut, which eventually pulled out the Ford and the Dodge. They got me stuck in the mud so I couldn't rehearse, and Chavez too has missed his work. Richie, he now fears the worst. He stood up his ex-wife, she called him a jerk. Of course, Holtman didn't have nothing better to do except ranch.
Chev got stuck in the Ford, got stuck in the Chevy, unstuck when the Dodge showed up. The Dodge got stuck in the tractor rut, which eventually pulled out the Ford.
Can you help me out?
Well, it was truck after truck, we all got stuck, except the big old 4x4 Hutterite truck. We all thought, Lord, are we in luck, but he wouldn't come anywhere near us. Mighty neighborly. Mighty neighborly. So we used a lot of our backs, a little of our brains. We jacked up the jacks and snugged up the chains. We all did our very best to refrain from shoveling. We put what timber we had underneath the wheels. We was all out of sand but managed to steal 2 sacks of the best modern canola seed you ever did see. That ought to give us some traction. The Chev got stuck in the Ford, got stuck in the Chevy, unstuck when the Dodge showed up. The Dodge got stuck in the tractor rut, which eventually pulled out the Ford. Epilogue. Well, we spilled genetically modified canola seed that was genetically modified for control of the weeds and for big old yields of margarine oil, raised hell all over that native prairie soil. Agriculture Canada is definitely going to be looking for us.
As corporate interests take more and more control of music and art in general, regionalism is really important, and because that's where you get the flavor from, right? Like, you know, everybody that moves to Nashville and stuff, you start writing about Nashville, you know, or writing about generic stuff, it just doesn't, at least for me, it's not as interesting. And for me, I'm much more interested in hearing somebody write about where they're from. I don't know, it keeps it pretty real for me to write about what I know, and I know Alberta.
Well, bud, smile.
Ian's one of the last great cowboy singers, you know. He's one of the last guys talking about this country and talking about cattle and breaking horses and all that kind of stuff. He's been one of the best chroniclers, I think, of our culture.
Have you got a pair of spurs? No, not here.
The whole cowboy thing, it's all based on the horse. It all started in Spain back 600 years ago. It's the horses that make cowboying attractive. I mean, without the horses, it doesn't work. You know, it's just tractor driving, you know.
What's the significance in the history of hackamores?
Well, it's Spanish, like all the good stuff, you know. It's Gordon. Oh, attaboy. Stay with her. Whoa, Pokey. Good ride, man. Good ride. If they get that on film, we got a f***ing Academy Award, man.
In the dinner party the other night, I sang your song.
Did you?
In New Mexico, they liked it.
Yeah. That's good. Yeah,
it's basically about old cowboys just parting ways and realizing that they're on the downside of, on the backside of their careers and lives. Like, it's neat too because we sort of trade off lines in the verses, and I do my line, and then he does his, and he puts the whole Tyson trip on it right away.
Rodeo's over, the folks gone home, and the cowboys are all down the road. Boys, it was a good one. They kicked a hole in the sky. And even the rank ones got rolled. 'Twas as wild as they come, and it was all mighty western. And none of us thought it could end. Finish it did. Bang.
I mean, we've already heard a million songs about California, and we've heard a million songs about Texas, and, you know, I don't think they've got anything on us, really. We just don't brag about it as much. I think that's part of my job as a songwriter, to sort of encapsulate my culture and put it out there for people.
'Cause our draws will be different, and our injuries will have healed. It's likely that the weather will change.
My approach to it was quite different than, let's say, Ian's, who really lives and breathes that, which is wonderful.
Welcome to Sun Country, starring Ian Tyson and presenting special guest Kathy Lang.
It represented, you know, the whole animal thing, the whole macho thing, guns. These things are things I really are quite opposite from.
What's gone by?
I wanted to
explore it from a different perspective. Explore it from a humor perspective and explore it from an intellectual perspective, from an open, like a liberal mindset rather than a conservative mindset, and turn it around. The whole cowboy aesthetic actually kind of turns me off, which is why I was drawn to it. I'm kind of like this weird moth or something. I like to dive right for something that is really annoying me.
She took piano lessons at Teresetta Convent in Castor. At that time, there wasn't a piano teacher closer. She didn't last long there. Kathy wouldn't practice, so I just said one day, enough. And she wanted to innovate. She wanted to do her thing on the piano, not what the Toronto Conservatory was telling her.
Dippity-do my hair to style, study the mirror for a while, take you home to wine and dine, put on the hi-fi, some Patsy Cline, I'm in love, hello.
The idea of Patsy Cline titillated me. To me, Patsy Cline sort of represented the kitsch aspect of country music, but also she had this honesty and this truth about her, and she was an extraordinary vocalist.
Two steps round and round the floor, promenade right out the door, lead you to your...
For me, I really think that the landscape of Alberta had a tremendous impact on my physical aesthetics, but also really helped develop my vocal style, which is actually quite different than what the contemporary vocal approach is today, which is very urban and very ornamented. And mine is quite minimal and quite languid and quite still. And I really think that that comes from the landscape and from the horizon of Alberta. Yeah, there's a lot of space, a lot of vastness, a lot of room.
It was all right for a while. I could smile for a while. Then I saw you last night. You held my hand so tight when you stopped.
I got asked to do Crying as a duet with Roy for a movie called Hiding Out. We ended up working together, and it was an amazing experience. We became, you know, quite close, good friends, and he died not soon after that, so it was pretty amazing that I had that moment there to share with him in life.
No, you don't love me, and I'll always be
I don't ever want to lead anyone to believe that I didn't enjoy my life in Alberta, because I certainly did, and I think it gave me a wonderful foundation to who I am and how I view the rest of the world, a great frame of reference. But I always, yeah, I was just waiting to go. I mean, I'm waiting to leave from here, but, you know, I just want to move forward. The world is such an amazing place.
If I kept driving just a couple more hours north, I'd be in Lac La Biche, which is actually the home of Crystal Plamondon. I don't think she's been spending a lot of time in Lac La Biche lately because she's been exploring the similarities between French music in Alberta and Cajun music in New Orleans.
First time I came here, I guess about 12 years ago, my family, Tommy and Mike and Laura said, you ought to come to a place where we hang out, you know. Man, we jammed all night, and everybody's playing music, and it was an open bar and food. First time I ate boiled crawfish. It was just like, it was just such a hangout place, like it just felt like home. And I'd never ever heard Cajun music, so I opened for this band, Mr. Hadley Castille and his son Blake, and they tell me, where do you come from? Utsal? Like, you're one of us. And I said, no, I'm from Plamondon. I mean, we just grew up with Phil and accordion. Then I hear their set, and I'm like, oh my God, this is like music from home. It's totally the same thing. He's just a spokesperson for the French, you know, the French music, because when he went to school, he wasn't allowed to speak French. That he was still in that era where, you know, they used to have to write lines, I will not speak French, it was only English. And that's why I relate with the Cajun people, because in Alberta, it was always been a struggle for us to keep our language.
La musique était arrêtée, les personnes étaient couchées, le plancher avait été vibré, les lumières n'étaient plus allumées. Mais la mélodie n'a porté dans ma tête.
I'd go in my room and I started writing the song thinking that the music had stopped, the floor had stopped vibrating from dancing, and the people had gone home. But the melody hadn't stopped in my head.
They say you can't go home again, but it's not really true in a sense. You can. Plamondon, I'm very proud of because it's my great-grandfather that founded it.
In 1908, him and his son came from Lake Lillinois, Michigan by covered wagon. And when they got here, they got to the top of the hill and they saw this little valley. They thought it was amazing. So they decided that this is where they're going to build a little town to keep their language and their culture and their religion.
When I was 10, my first gig, I was a little bitty, skinny little thing with two little braids and knee socks to here, a lot of freckles, and I had a big voice for a little kid, you know. And I got paid $5. That was a lot. I remember them paying me in quarters because I thought that was a huge amount of cash. And I mean, scared to death because I was so shy. And my dad would always say, you know, come on, sing, you're good, let's go. He'd always like, you know, give me some positive energy. Let's go, you can do it. And then so I remember getting on stage and closing my eyes because thinking, I don't want to see anybody. If I just close my eyes, they won't be there, you know? My first memories of this hall was like, that was the big times. Because this town had so many bands. At one time, there was 12 bands in this town of a population of probably 500 people. And so it was like, if you got to get to be at this hall, your band, you had her made.
Savoir-Brasser,
really cool that we're here because I got married here and I graduated here and everybody else's weddings and graduations and after funerals everybody comes here. So in a small town, a community center is a big thing. It's wild because I've lived all over, but it's like when I come here, that's home. I'm home here.
Southern Alberta is an ancient place, settled 20,000 years ago by the first Native peoples to make Alberta their home. Alex Wells, world champion hoop dancer, returns to Head Smashed in Buffalo Jump, a sacred place to the Blackfoot hunters who once drove thousands of buffalo over these cliffs.
Big part of our history, the way we used to live a long time ago, and like we like to carry that on to our next generation and telling the stories and keeping like historical sites like this open, you know, for other people to learn about it and also to walk the ground to where our hunting grounds used to be. Different grasses, the flowers that we used for food or for you know, for paint, you know, different things like that, you know, we all used from the Mother Earth, and our style of dances that we have, like we interpret the movements of animals. Traditionally, that's where most of our movement has come from, is by watching the way of life of the animals, the buffalo, the horses, the deer, the birds, you know, the eagles, important symbols that we use.
If you're dancing here versus in a community center or a fair or something like that, what's running through your mind? Are you thinking a little bit closer to the traditional?
Yeah, like you know, the bigger the crowd, the more sure you are.
The faster the spins.
The spins go. You know, different places you dance. Like if I was dancing in front of more Native people, I'll keep more to the traditional of it,
I suppose.
And, you know, for people who want to see a show or, you know, what we like to do, you know, I'd pick it up more and, you know, add different styles. Some place like this, you know, I'd like to keep it more traditional, just like, because it is like a sacred place to the Native people here. Yeah. You can depict a dancer from where they come from by the designs that they wear on their outfits. The style of dance is particular for each style of outfit. The colors that we use are given to us traditionally through ceremony, or are they passed down from family, or it represents, you know, the water, or it represents, you know, the sun, you know, different things like that. It's tradition.
Coming up on Alberta Bound, Jan Arden. This year, the music of a little-known Alberta folk singer turned up on primetime television as a featured song in the hit series Joan of Arcadia. Carla Anderson. The name doesn't ring a bell right away. Well, don't worry, it will. She's one of the newest, freshest faces on the Alberta music scene. She's from Spruce Grove. She's a single mother of three boys. And rumor has it that she did a lot of her music writing on her own in a chicken coop on a farmstead much like this one.
Sometimes it's up here, sometimes it's down, sometimes
sometimes it's too late.
I was a daydreamer. That was, I think, on every report card I ever had.
But the point of it all is that we keep on. No matter what's come, no matter what's gone.
I remember laying in the grass and just processing the space here, the prairie sky.
Yeah, Race, you ready?
We do a lot of exploring around here. All my kids are rock hounds. That's the thing that's neat for them to see. I mean, when you're talking about the Badlands area there, you know, I mean, you're in a different world. All the rock formation is different. The colors are different.
Can you smell it? Does it smell like anything?
Yeah, it smells really good.
This time of year when things are coming to life, it's so, I come to life. The prairies is wide, it's vast. And then you come to a place like this where it's a different kind of silence. This is an ancient place. This is a place where lives have lived and, you know, in a very different way we have. A good friend of mine's daughter passed away. She was 21 years old. And all I remember is wishing I just had a blanket because there was no saying, it's okay or it's going to be okay or you're going to be all right. And going home and feeling like what can you do? What can I do? There's nothing that I can do. Like, that's the... letting people go into their grief.
What else can I do? Bring a blanket for you. Or to wrap around your shoulders or put upon your knees. Try to keep the cold away. Keep your heart from turning.
Moments drop in from outside. You make a choice to grab it or to write it down. You get a window, a space where you take a picture, and that is the song.
I have tears for you when another tear will fall. Will you feel like dying or feel nothing at all? Well, there's nothing left, Lord, we can do or say. Thank you.
Okay, if anybody represents the new urban Alberta, it's got to be Calgary's Jan Arden. This summer, she gave me an up-close and very personal tour of the city she grew up in.
Did you ever feel like you had to leave Calgary to make it, to do what you wanted to do?
I did have something to prove to myself in my 20s. I did want to do well. I did want to have my parents pleased with me. I mean, they were very reluctant to see me go into music.
I've got money in my pocket. I like the color of my hair. I've got a friend who loves me. Got a house. I've got a car. I've got a good mother. And her voice is what keeps me.
Home is where you hang your heart, and generally home for all of us is, you know, has to do with family. And I think all the music that I've done is very reflective of being from the prairies and being from wide open spaces and dealing with 8 months of winter every year, and maybe I don't know any better. I certainly didn't think that music was going to be a career for me, but, you know, it's been that beacon that's very much like Alberta that keeps bringing you back, bringing you back.
We got to figure out why Alberta's so important.
Let's just get in the car and go, because I'll just point out things.
Let's party.
This is interesting, Kurt.
I'm ready.
People that are not from here say Calgary.
Yes.
People that are from here say Calgary.
Calgary.
You know where we're going?
No. Oh, yes. Left. Good. Good, my darling.
Better?
Does this say no left turn? Or no, we're all right. Halt. So, are we going to make it? Oh, look at you. This truck is... Glad it's you driving and not me. But the thing you have to understand about the Blackfoot truck stop is that it's open 24 hours. They have a lemon meringue pie there. The meringue is a foot high. Oh, my God. There it is. A beacon of hope.
It's so good. I mean, it's not a foot high, but it's not bad.
Beautiful. You got just a little bit on you.
Watch the lipstick.
There you go.
Oh! Wow. This is turning out to be a pretty good day. It's hard getting into this truck. Wait.
Do you happen to have anything I could break into my car with? Yeah.
That was one of the weirdest questions I've ever heard. Is this diesel? No, no, we're going to gun it. That's okay. No, do what I do. We're going to the Glamorgan Bowling Alley. Just two doors down is the Glamorgan Bakery, which I swear to you
on any given day, there's a lineup for cheese buns. What?
Still some pie there. It made me hungry. Cheese story.
Why is it?
There's pie on the roof. I forgot it there.
Look at Mountain View Bolarama.
Oh, it's not called Glamorgan.
See, it used to be called the Glamorgan. Maybe it was always Mountain View. Kurt! Okay, we have to buy liquor. Do I have money?
You don't have a line of credit at the cheese bun store?
Oh, wait, there's a loony. Okay, we're good to go.
All right.
Surely to God, a cheese bun can't be more than $2.
Okay.
Please. No, I've had them.
They're very good.
They're really, really, really good. He's gonna pick his ball. Jesus, that's heavy. I think we're supposed to have special shoes. It's all right.
Look at this. It's a strike!
Do you know what? I think it's nice that we're taking this trip.
I think we're getting close to the hotel where my mom and dad spent their wedding night.
Wow. That's a little bit too much information.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Next on Alberta Bound, Oscar Lopez and the Alberta Ballet. Oscar Lopez immigrated to Alberta 25 years ago as a political refugee from his native Chile.
I believe strongly in destiny. That's my destiny, playing music and coming from such a long way, like Chile, for a reason. It was for a reason. And, you know, now I know. The reason was just to play music. This country did give me the opportunity to be able to develop the music that I've been creating for a long time.
I think Oscar is the essence of music, and he can just grab his guitar and start singing and playing, and then suddenly you're enthralled.
When I play, I close my eyes, I go to a different world. I have no idea which world is it, but I know in my heart that I'm just having a great time. And when you have a good time, people will have a good time.
And that's the kind of music, that kind of powerful music that really comes from the gut, that can make really a good soundtrack for dance. It can really provide good energy for dancers. From Chile, working with a choreographer from Quebec on ballet dancers trained in Toronto. These art forms all mixing together is wonderful.
So guys, let's walk that way, and Kelly will start, okay? When Kelly does the first movement, you start.
Okay.
So let me see that, guys. Just
it's an important connection. It's a chemistry in there between dancers and guitar players or music in general.
That's it.
You know, the strength of ballet dancers is the extreme positions they can create with their bodies. And so I wanted to really try to marry what ballet can do at its best with what this, the intensity and the heat of this music.
That's doing very well. Okay, good. That's it.
And I think that, you know, if we can do this kind of technically demanding dance that almost looks like it's being improvised to Oscar's music, then we will have something that's much more alive.
The family of Raghav Mathur traveled to Alberta from India, halfway around the world. And in a Calgary high school classroom, he and a friend began to record a fusion of Hindi and Western music. And in the last year, well, he's had 3 top 10 hits in England.
Anytime you come back home, it's very special. And to come home after having the success in England and doing what we did in India. Come back to Calgary and do it. It's very special.
What's up, Calgary, you gay?
Was always meant to be the first single. It would bang in any club anywhere in the world, and at the same time, it has this sample from an old Bollywood film from 1950 something. And it captures everything about my musicality in 3 minutes. If you take away the Indian sample and everything, it's an R&B record. If I just sang that with a guitar, it would be an R&B record. Iceberg comes on there and he represents hip-hop, and I grew up loving hip-hop. Rap is the poetry of the 21st century.
Doesn't get more Calgary than this. Mm. Cowboy music, country music, and you wanted to maybe sing country music, or is that...
Well, I used to listen to a lot of it, and you know, a lot of people say that's so different from what you do now.
It's very different.
It's like R&B, reggae, but you know, music's so connected, you know. The difference between country and gospel and reggae and R&B and even Indian music, I mean, it's all really linked when you look at it. And for me, the storytelling aspect of country music, you know, the songwriting and that whole kind of aspect of country music is still big in what I do today. Yeah,
'cause my baby's got... One of the interesting challenges was definitely the language. Raghav would tell me to go to one part in the track. It's all in Indian and I don't speak Hindi, so that was an interesting challenge. We would start after school, as soon as the halls are a little bit quieter, and we would go till 2 and 3 in the morning most days, take lots of breaks, play basketball in the gym.
Neil and I have an ongoing 21 tournament. I'm we're pretty much tied at the moment, so maybe later on we should do that.
Who says you can't play basketball wearing pink? Oh, did you get that? There's no one above it. We all need some loving, some kissing and hugging.
Like,
we're going to places like in Europe where there's not an Indian person in the crowd. They just like the vibe of the show. And we have as many, you know, white fans and black fans as fans of Indian origin. So I think it says a lot for how the world's kind of coming together and how music does, you know, as cheesy as it sounds, bridges a lot of those gaps.
What's it feel like you've got 13,000 people and you know that in the next 30 seconds you're going to do this one part of your song that everyone knows it and everyone's going to freak out? Do you feel like a god?
No, I think you feel very, very, very human, and you realize that, you know, you can get this right or you can get this wrong, and you just got to do it for the right reason. You know, I think if I got up there and I went, you know, this part is going to be the climax, and I'm just going to get there, and it's an instant, and it's going to work, I think would be so arrogant that probably they'd say, this guy, he's not doing it for the right reason.
Coming up next on Alberta Bound, Paul Brandt.
Baby, nobody will. A genuine Canadian man. Well, that barely sounds like a Paul Brandt song called Canadian Man. And I used it on a Cross Canada tour a couple of years ago. It was a lot of fun to skate to.
Ladies and gentlemen, the most awarded male vocalist in Canadian country music history, Paul Brandt.
Cause we got a little convoy rocking through the night. Yeah, we got a little convoy. Ain't she a beautiful sight? Come on, join our convoy. Nothing gonna get in our way. Gonna roll this trucking convoy across the USA. Outbreaker pig pen, this here's the duck. And you wanna back off them hogs? 10-4, about 5 mile or so. 10, roger. Them hogs is getting intense up here.
Have the opportunity to, been able to go to the States and play my music for people there and be recognized by the Country Music Association down there for developing country music and being an ambassador for it. I mean, that's great. You know, it was a true honor.
If there's any musician in this show that epitomizes the words Alberta Bound, it's definitely Paul. He's just moved back from Nashville, back to Alberta, to the province where he grew up in.
I just couldn't get the thought of being back in Alberta and back in the foothills and around my family out of my mind. And so this kind of feels like a part of the dream. When I lived in Nashville, Liz and I would drive up and stop along the way at a couple of different bed and breakfasts and throw the dogs in the truck and just take our time. It was a time to kind of disconnect and unwind. And it's always an exciting feeling when you see that Sweetgrass sign and you know that you're getting close to the border. Alberta is such a huge part of who I am. My grandmother, her name actually was Alberta. She grew up down in the Crow's Nest Pass, and my grandfather and great-grandfather before me were coal miners. So much about the hills and the prairies, the mountains, all of those things evoked images of Alberta to me, and it just flowed into that song.
Sunset, 40 miles to Canada, my truck.
Being there in the Sweetgrass Hills in Riding on Stone Provincial Park, it almost feels like you're on a different planet. I mean, there's something surreal about it and just peaceful and calm.
And so I cranked up the radio, cause there's just a little more to go before I cross the border at that Sweetgrass sign. I'm Alberta bound, this piece of heaven that I found. Rocky mountains and black fertile ground. Everything I need beneath that big blue sky. It doesn't matter where I go, this place will always be my home. It's a pride that's been passed down to me. Deep as coal mines, wide as farmers' fields. Yeah, I've got independence in my veins. Maybe it's my down-home redneck roots or these dusty old Alberta boots. But like a Chinook wind keeps coming back again. Till I die.
I think Alberta to Canadians is still the Wild West.
Yeah, I'm Alberta bound.
You know, it's a frontier and a place of opportunity. And I don't think that it's ever going to stop being that.
Ooh, I'm Alberta bound.
My first introduction to the world of shumka dancing was with my good friend and competitor Mike Slipchuk and his older sister Dory. It was green fields just like these that attracted generations of Ukrainians, some dancers, some not, to this incredible land we call Alberta.
This is St. John's Ukrainian Orthodox Church, and it's the church I was raised in. I went here on Sundays, but I also came here on Saturdays for the dreaded Saturday school, which meant language and history and geography in the morning. And in the afternoon was dancing. But we had a ballerina from Ukraine. But she was petite and she wore her hair all pulled back. And she had one of those kind of grim-looking black outfits and slippers on her feet. She said, hands on hips in Ukrainian. Of course, hands on hips. Раз, два, раз, два, три. Раз, два, раз, два, три. One,
two, three, four. Back front, back front, back front. Plie. One.
It's an interesting thing because you might expect that ethnic activity is highest at the immigrant generation and then kind of lowers a little bit. The model of assimilation would expect that a fifth generation person would be less active in ethnic activity than the immigrant. But Ukrainian dancing in Western Canada and shumka doesn't fit that pattern at all. Actually, it's something born of Canada just as much as it is born of Ukrainian ancestry.
Shaky.
I'm okay.
Hope like heck that you get in. It's always wonderful to see young, fresh passion and talent come through our doors. And we do this usually only once or twice a year. So there's a lot of excitement and hype and energy.
Everything else is the same except for the plie, relevé, coupé, extend.
In the audition, we look for obviously a high technical standard.
A good personality. Obviously, technical aspect as well. Someone who can perform on stage with our company and who has a good attitude.
Beautiful, just get there, ready, and hold. A little faster, up, up, boom, and rest, two, three, bum, shene, yata, ten, tolave, finish.
To have that intrinsic love and desire and passion for culture and art, and to put that onto the world stage is just something that's that really important.
Six, and pistolet in the air. Land, right leg extended, left arm up.
I like how it's more experimental than a lot of other groups. It's not like old Ukrainian, it's fun. It's like more modern elements.
Finish with prisyatka right, prisyatka left, prisyatka right. Repeat last time. One, turn, two, turn, three, turn, pose.
The kind of dancing that shumka does isn't danced in Ukraine. It's a Canadian-made, Ukrainian-made fusion in a lot of ways.
I personally like kopak or just regional dances, just being able to give her and go really fast and dance your heart out and really fast tempos and
traditional dancers, but it's development, right? Develop. And you know, they need new language for this. Ukrainian, but it's a little bit turning to our time.
I took my Baba and Yido when they were still alive to a Pesenka festival in Vegreville in the mid-70s, right? And there were all these little dance groups that got up from Two Hills and from Murnim and from Mandera and from Vegreville and so on. And Baba and Yido were a little mystified. See, what is this? What are they doing? Right? This wasn't Ukrainian village dance. This was art dance. So you have this generation, I think, of the pioneers or the immigrants who didn't know this stuff. This was something you learned to do once you were in the cities, almost. Shumka is the little company that grew. For the longest time, Shumka was still, for me, just a Ukrainian event, just for us. We knew about it. We knew what was going on. We knew who the dancers were. We knew the music. And then suddenly, it became a public affair.
Last year, we had a great opportunity to travel to China. We did a 7-city tour in China, mainland China and Hong Kong. And it was just wonderful to see the reactions from the people. You know, the dance is fresh and lively, and just to see their response to what we bring was really remarkable to be able to share what we do on an international level. We love where we're at. We love our country, and we're just willing to share that to the world and to people anywhere.
Next on Alberta Bound, PJ Perry.
It's a little embarrassing, man. I don't know how I became a figure skater. I don't know how it happened, but I mean, my father has been on every single one of those mountains, and he knows through this pass, you'll get stuck. You'll waste a whole day trying to get to the other side of the mountain because you can't get through. He just knows like the back of his hand. I was a country kid. I grew up in a small town that the population doubled at 9 o'clock in the morning because school started. There was no cell phones, there was no ties. I think growing up here, I really loved winter with the snow, the digging of forts, the, you know, knocking snow off branches. And skating outside to this day is one of my favorite ways to skate because it's the perfect skating. There was perfect times where the ice would freeze clear and you could chase fish.
The gravel roads around Pincher Creek lead to the ranch of Governor General Award-nominated writer Sid Marty. And at the heart of Sid's world lie the Livingstone Mountains, an endangered wilderness that Sid, like my dad, has fought to preserve.
There's a lot of body action in
here. Yeah, so you get into it. That's it, yeah. Bit more volume.
I think it broke a tooth.
What drives your Alberta spirit, and what motivates your music and motivates your writing?
Well, in a way, it's the mountains. That's a big factor. Mountains, foothills. I was raised on the prairies, as was my wife, but I've lived in the foothills and mountains for quite a while. I live just over here against the Livingstone Range we see in the background here.
Well, my father's very last of the real men, if some people have said, and, you know, the guiding, outfitting and the trapping, and I feel like I'm meeting
yeah.
What Alberta's all about when I meet you.
I spent a lot of my working life as a park warden roaming the mountains with saddle and pack horses, you know, and I met guys like your dad in the mountains. And that was a rare privilege, and it influenced my life greatly, and it influenced what I write about and what I care about to this day.
Along the mountain rim, tonight there will be snow again. Frost along my pony's back, that wind begins to blow.
It's a small ranching town, it's a friendly little place. In my opinion, it's one of the most beautiful on earth.
Southern ladies just follow the sun, she'll return when warm rains come. Down along the Livingstone.
People from various walks of life, all of them united by the fact that they like music. They like live music.
You can see Chief Mountain rising through the Montana snow down there.
My wife's cafe has served that function for quite a while, and she's been quite a force behind bringing live music into this part of the world for 20 years.
Late spring storms, new dogies pour. Gotta find them, boys, they'll die out there alone.
I like that kind of intimacy. I like that kind of lack of equipment. The equipment gets in the way. It's a place where they can go and hang out and try their songs out, have friends back them up, and just play some live music.
Down along the Livingstone.
I'm standing here on the shores of Sylvan Lake. It's a beautiful spring day, 2005, but I want to take us back. Behind me, 1950, there's what you see now isn't there. It's not the Raccoon Lodge. It's a beautiful dance hall. It's huge. It's the best dance hall in all of Alberta. It's where everyone goes from hundreds of miles, dressed up to the nines. All the big bands come through here. It's the swing era. I'm told that the floor has horsehair underneath it, so you can dance all night like a feather. It's where the party is. And it was here in this environment that a young 14-year-old PJ Perry learned his craft and became one of Canada's premier alto sax players.
What I think is interesting about a waltz is it's a jazz tune, but it's got a country feel to it. It's a tune that came out of my background in this part of the country, surrounded by all the different influences, the country, the dance band, all sort of entered into my subconscious, and then when I wanted to compose this piece of music, those kind of roots just came out in the writing. My father was a great tenor player. When he was a little boy in Wadena, Saskatchewan, he lived in the attic of the farmhouse, and he had a crystal radio that he could pick up the Count Basie band and all of the bands of its time being broadcast live from nightclubs in Chicago. My dad had given me a saxophone on my 11th birthday, and by the time I was 14, he introduced me into the band. Dad was sitting in front leading the band, and my Uncle Jim was sitting beside me, and that's where I learned how to play. My father was a taskmaster. He took things very seriously, and he ran a tight ship. I was trying to learn how to play jazz, and whenever I got a solo, I would veer from the melody and I would start taking off and playing jazz solos in the middle of some of the more commercial tunes. And I would look over and my dad would be looking at me and he'd say, "Stick to the melody." Well, Varsity Hall was one of the largest dance halls in on the prairies. It was huge. We could stuff 1,200 people in there on a busy Saturday night. It was a hardwood dance floor, and my Uncle Jim used to take great pride in throwing wax on it and seeing that it was in good shape for dancing.
And it was a little town, a very narrow-minded little town. They were against dancing in general. They were against anybody making any money or having any fun.
During that time in Alberta, Sunday was still a Sunday. No businesses were open. Dancing was prohibited, and drinking.
And one time we were called off the floor. The floor, we were dancing too lively. And the floor master called the orchestra to a stop. And he said, we will have a respectable dance here or none at all.
Tommy was here in the early 50s. I was 13 or 14 years old. Tom would drive down to come and say hi to the guys and hang out and play some of the jam sessions that took place all the time. I said, Tommy, you remember Abide With Me? And he said, yeah, no problem. So we did it as a duo without the bass and without the drums, and it turned out to be something very special. Me about Silver Lake was the fact that there were so many great musicians, a veritable who's who of Canadian jazz musicians, yeah, that came through the hall and had the opportunity to play seven nights a week. These things don't exist anymore. For me, to sit beside you and learn how to play music was an education that is invaluable. I've told you this before, but I just think that I was the luckiest person in the world to be playing in a saxophone section with my dad and you.
Well, I'll tell you, when he showed him where middle C was, and he was off.
Coming up on Alberta Bound, Ian Tyson. Well, after battling the elements all day, we're about here. This is what Ian Tyson calls his stone house. Ian Tyson is the last link to the real cowboy world, I think.
My father came here in 1906. He said it was the last year of the open range. There were no fences in 1906. By 1908, it was all gone. It was all fenced. But he saw the tail end of it. As a writer and an artist, I value that culture tremendously.
Well, I was hanging around town just to spend me time, out of the job and not making a dime.
Well, we all grew up on Wilf Carter. His importance, his impact as an iconic figure. You know, Wilf Carter was kind of the Alberta ecosystem put to music. I wrote a song once called The Wonder of It All, and it says, they'll never count the stars and they'll never fence the sky. It's an attitude, and that's kind of an attitude thing that we have in Alberta. The cowboy's been dying ever since Remington painted and Charlie Russell. I mean, they bemoaned it then, and that was in 1890. So cowboys are like, you know, like fires, forest fires. They you think they're all died out, and then they pop up.
In the land of the long roads, high lonesome prairie. Dreaming of the springtime, first crocus in the snow, coffee in a gold cup, he's headed for the oil rig, land of shining mountains, big Alberta sky. Castle, the red deer and the battle, river
rivers in a dry land feed the cities of the plain. Nothing lasts forever on the Great Divide, land of shining mountains, big Alberta sky.
The British ranching hierarchy in Alberta, they didn't want those American cowboys in here. They were trouble. But they found out they couldn't, there was no other way to do it. They had to have cowboys. There was no other way around it.
I have felt the wind and rain, but like the cowboys said, wish I'd seen the buffalo. Maybe they'll come back again. He's gonna get up early and try and make a dollar. The only girl he wanted took the Greyhound for the coast, and she was bound for leaving, but she will not forget him or the land of shining mountains, big Alberta sky. Land of shining mountains, big Alberta sky.
Every day above ground is a good one for me. I mean, you know, that's the way we feel, guys my age. I mean, you know, every day, if I'm vertical, I'm a happy guy, you know. I don't care about the aches and pains as long as I'm vertical.
I always liked Four Strong Winds, but mostly because my mom sang it. But now that I've been around the Creator, it just means a little bit more. I mean, I sing it to my son when he was really little, trying to get him to go to sleep. I think the song is eerie. It's kind of sad. But it makes you feel good when you hear it or when you sing it. I think there's a reason that when CBC did a survey that it was voted number one song. It just makes you feel Canadian.
I remember it very well. Rainy October afternoon, and Bob Dylan sang me a song in the Kettle of Fish down on McDougal Street. And I thought, heck, it can't be that hard to do that. So I wrote this song. Little did I know it was going to get harder. But it just seemed to be there. It just seemed to be, you know, in the air, and you could pluck it out of the air.
Four strong winds that blow lonely, seven seas that run. All those things that don't change, come what may. Our good times are all gone. I'm bound for moving on. I'll look for you if I'm ever back this way. I think I'll go out to Alberta. Weather is good there in the fall. I've got some friends that I could go to work in for. Still, I wish you'd change your mind if I'd ask you one more time. But we've been through that 100 times or more. Four strong winds that blow lonely, seven seas that run high. All those things that don't change, come what may. Our good times are all gone. I'm bound for moving on. I'll look for you if I back this way.
I'm from BC originally. I'm not from Alberta. But I came here rodeoing
in the 50s.
And I really liked it here, and I guess it was always in the back of my mind to return here. Finally, I did in 76.
If I get there before the snow flies, if things are looking good, you can meet me. If I send you down the fair, but by then it will be winter, there ain't too much for you to do, 'cause those winds sure blow cold way out there. For strong winds that blow lonely, seven seas that run high, all those things that don't change, come on, May. Our good times are all gone, I'm bound for moving on. I'll look for you if I'm never back this way. I'll look for you if I'm ever back this way.
People come into the country who come because they just love it. They're just captivated by the beauty of this landscape, which, in my opinion, is one of the most beautiful on earth.
All the music that I've done is very reflective of being from the prairies and being from wide open spaces and dealing with 8 months of winter every year.
I just couldn't get the thought of being back in Alberta and back in the foothills and around my family out of my mind.
I'm surprised how many times I think of that little town, you know, all the time. Like, there's so much, so many good memories.
I'm so proud to be from Canada that, you know, I wear my maple leaf tattoo very proudly wherever I go. And
what does Alberta mean to Terry? One word: home.